Good morning.
Good morning.
We'll have the youth and children's classes this evening at 5:00. And then Bible study will be on Wednesday at 6:00. And today is Pentecost. And so we're so glad to get to see you today on this great feast day of the Lord. Are there any other announcements? There are no other announcements. When you stand, as we reaffirm our faith together, I believe in God
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and buried, the third day He rose from the dead, He ascended to heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Do not resuscitate order, so they have taken her off the ventilator. She's been in that
in prayer for her family as they wait, and just be in prayer for them. This is my daddy's last remaining sister.
There's some young girl in Vanaway. I know there's several family members that was asking prayer for a Woods family that she's, his family comes back.
Can you give us that day on that?
We don't know anything. We go to where that doctor's appointment for tomorrow was put off because somebody else was going to be out in the store. He sees an ear, nose, and throat on the 2nd of June, 2nd or 3rd, and they're just looking for anything that might be causing these issues. But he seems to, he's trying to wean himself off the oxygen, so I'm trying to get on his own for a long period of time. So
he has good days and bad days. He may be a neat singer in a good way.
I just turned this on. Can you turn it down? I'm afraid it's going to get some feedback.
Diane has a show for surgery.
Oh, is that doing it?
Diane.
I may have fixed it.
My mother-in-law, Diane.
Thanks.
Lucy.
How's the sound now, Mr. Dahl?
I can't hear you.
Oh. Is it okay? All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ron. Now, hold on just a second. After the Woods family and Mr. Lynn, I didn't catch the last one.
Diane said the shoulder surgery.
Miss Diane. Okay. When is that, Miss Diane? Thursday. Okay. I knew if we had that feedback here a minute ago, we had set some hearing aids to hurt some people.
And Drew said thank you for recognizing him. He's got about 3 weeks till he finishes that degree, and he's working at two different jobs too. So he's in his house sale goes through Tuesday. Just that'll be one more thing I don't have to worry about.
and that reminds me of something else. Thank all of y'all who are such a major part in that, just even being here and supporting our graduates. Thank y'all for that. So sweet. And all of the money and the love and the appreciation that you showed for them as they're going to a new part of their lives. Really sweet. Anyone else? Well, if there are no others, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let me pray for the Clay Simmons family, the Harry Clay Simmons family. And let me pray for Ms. Rita's family with her aunt. And Lord, that Lord, you just touch her in the name of Christ and their family. We pray for the Woods family, and we pray, God, that you will just bring that child home safely. We pray for Miss Diane's surgery. And Lord, that she's able to have relief for that shoulder, and Lord, that she'll be able to be back with us quickly. And Lord God, I pray for Mr. Lynn, that you'll touch him. And God, we pray for Ms. Ruth and for Mary Ashley and for Billy Harold, and Lord, for others that are on our prayer list. And Lord, for people who just need a little extra grace or a little extra touch from you, oh God, Lord, that they'll feel your presence, oh Lord, in the name of Christ. And as you taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's take our red hymnals and stand as we sing hymn number 508, Love That You Made. Let's sing all three verses, hymn number 508.
Thank you.
See you.
Turn in your Bibles to Joel chapter 2.
The book of Joel. That's in the Minor Prophets. They're kind of hard to find, but after the Major Prophets is the last set of books at the end of the Old Testament. Joel chapter 2. Starting in verse 28. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also on my men servants and on my maid servants I will pour out my spirit in those days. And I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillar of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The word of God for the people of God. You know, this was a prophecy hundreds of years before Jesus. And he's saying that, you know, that this doesn't sound so odd to us because it's been fulfilled, a lot of this passage. You'd say, well, so on the men servant and on the maid servants and on the and the old men shall dream dreams and the young men will see visions. And he'd say, well, we've heard of things like that. But, you know, and it says, and whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And we'd say, well, of course it's true. Romans 10:13 says that whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But in the book of Joel, this is an unprecedented thing in that day and time. The young men and the old men just randomly receiving from the Lord, or kind of hard to cough with the microphone on it. Block the microphone more than blocking the spores. Anyway, you know, it'd be common for the prophets to prophesy in that day. It'd be common for the group of Levites, for them to be the ones preaching, because those are the ones who do it. But what Joel is saying is one day, it won't be uncommon for even a carpenter to preach or a fisherman to preach the gospel. And that's exactly what they saw in Jesus' day. And he said, I'm my men servants and maid servants. That'd be the equivalent of saying, you know, the people that work for you as hired hands on the farms, who are the ones just plowing the field, and they've never had a day of education, and they may or may not go to church, that they, God is going to pour out His Spirit on them, and they're going to begin to prophesy, and they're going to begin to preach, and you're going to see God raising up the new generation, and on the servant girls in the household. And you know then what I think about? Remember at the wedding at Cana of Galilee, what happened? They said, Jesus' mother said, ladies, whatever my son tells you to do, you do it. And he said, go fill up all the water pots to the brim. It said they had those pots that were used for washing, for purification. He said, fill them up to the brim. And then he turned the water into wine. And then they served it to the master of the feast. And it said, but he did not know where the wine came from. But what did he say after that? He said, but who knew? The servants knew. Fulfilling this passage in Joel, on my men servants and on my maid servants. So here, the maidservants at the wedding of Cana of Galilee was a prophetic fulfillment of Joel chapter 2. Jesus can do it, and he can do it again and again and again. In the days of Pentecost, and a lot of times people say, well, the first Pentecost was Acts chapter 2. Oh, no. No, the first Pentecost is Mount Sinai, because that's the day that God gave Moses the Ten Commandments. And he was excited to give God, to give God's word to the people. That's the first Pentecost. But it says that he's going to take our heart of stone and make it a heart of flesh. Just read that with me. It's in Ezekiel 36, verse 26. Ezekiel 36, verse 26. This is prophesying as to the difference of what happened from the first Pentecost to Acts chapter 2. Being up on that Mount Sinai and God giving his word, and he's excited to give his word, but he writes it on tablets of stone. Because they're not ready for it to be on their hearts, are they? Because remember what happened? Moses comes down and he gets furious because of their idolatry. They're not ready. They are not ready for Pentecost. And so Moses throws the tablets to the ground, and then he goes back up on the mountain. He gets the second set of tablets. And then when he comes back, what happens? There's a plague, and God, because of the idolatry, 3,000 are killed, right? Isn't that what happened? That's in Exodus. And so they're not ready for Pentecost. But let's read in Ezekiel 36, verse 26. I will give you a new heart. I will put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of what? Stone. I'll take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you'll keep my judgments and do them. And then you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. Now we're dealing with something else right there, as it says, you'll dwell in the land that I gave your fathers. You know, dwelling in Canaan land is not just a place. It's a reign of God. So here, in God's house, where Christ is reigning in this room, we are dwelling in Canaan land. We are dwelling in the land that God has given to the forefathers, because God is reigning right here in this place. You know, he said, I'm going to give you a trade that heart of stone for a heart of flesh. So on the first Pentecost, he writes his word down on tablets of stone. But in Acts chapter 2, can you imagine how excited that God got when he says, today I get to write it on their hearts. It's no longer just going to be on pages on a piece of stone. I mean, words on a piece of stone or words in our Bible. It's going to also, I'm going to get to write it on their hearts, says the Lord. And they're going to keep my statutes. And that's what happened. And I'll just read it to you real quick, and you've heard it so many times in Acts 2. It says, and when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing and a mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them divided tongues as of fire, and it sat upon each one of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. People begin to hear in their own dialects. Now, remember, I've often said that the only people up until this time were on the Jews. That was the only believers. And they were predominantly living in Israel. But I use the word predominantly because there were some who were living in the diaspora. These are people who had gone out during the exiles. People who had, during
you know, during the Babylonian conquest. So this would be, they left during the time of Jeremiah and the time of Daniel. And remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and they're over there in Babylon. So there's groups of Israelites still living in Babylon in different areas. And so these are the people who would come in for high holy days. But they would speak a little different dialect of Hebrew or Aramaic when they would come into town. Even though they all spoke Hebrew. In fact, I remember as a child hearing the ones who would come in from the Rush of Poland there, and the version of Hebrew that they spoke was kind of like, it's called Yiddish. It would be a mix of Hebrew and German of sorts. And so you have different dialects of the Hebrew, but it's saying that all of a sudden, whenever the day of Pentecost had fully come, all of a sudden they all began to hear in their own dialect what the wonderful words of God, the gospel message. And when that message was preached, hallelujah, Peter preached that message. Now remember, I was telling you a minute ago that in Exodus, that 3,000 died because of their idolatry. Remember that? Well, this is an important figure, and that's why I told you. It's Exodus 32, verse 28. That it says that 3,000 died because of their idolatry on that first day of Pentecost. But guess what happens in Acts chapter 2 on this day of Pentecost? In Acts 2, verse 41, 3,000 get saved. Isn't that amazing? It says that 3,000 were added to the church that day. You know, I'd forgotten that fact. And I was talking to one of my former church members, And they reminded me of it. And I said, I'd forgotten that. And I began to research it. And I was like, well, there it is. That's exactly. And it said, well, Brother Ron, you told us. And I didn't remember. But have y'all ever had that moment where you've learned something and you taught others, but then it slipped your mind? Welcome to life, right? It happened to me too. But anyway, but so 3,000 were killed because of their idolatry, but over in Acts chapter 2, all of a sudden 3,000 are added to the church that day when that message is preached. And Peter preached it. But all of a sudden all of these people were able to hear in their own dialect what God's wanting to say to them of the gospel message. You know, I was talking to somebody this week, and they were saying, Brother Ron, why do you think that we don't see revivals like we once saw? And I said, that's a good question. I think it's because people are just not hungry for the Lord like they used to be. And you know, we need to be hungry for the Lord. You know, when I think about hungry, I have a certain sermon that I preach on that. And it's about the lepers. And that these were lepers, and they said that they were going to go into the city they were going to go into the camp that the Assyrians had encircled it, and sieged the city. And so they said, we're going to eat tonight. We're going to go into that Syrian camp, and we're going to go get some food. And they just didn't know that God was going to cause the Assyrians to hear a sound of chariots and of horses, and that they were going to have taken off and run for their lives. And then the lepers were going to go in and be able to feast and eat. And they did. They were able to feast and eat. But they had to get hungry. They had to get hungry. They had to come to a point in their life where they had to make a decision. We're going to eat tonight. Either we're going to eat down here, or they're going to kill us, and we're going to eat up there. And that's what they got. Otherwise, this would be like us going to a church eating like we had last week, for all those good foods that all y'all had prepared. And somebody to say, nah, I'm not hungry. I'll just have a glass of water. You got to be hungry. And you think about those good foods. And I've heard some people talk about the different foods this week, and they'd say about the food that was cooked and say, well, now who made this or who made this? And I'm so glad that I knew I was able to answer them. I'd say, well, so-and-so made this or this one made that and that kind of thing. And say, oh, we got to get that recipe because it was so good. So everybody just went on and on about y'all's cooking. That's what I've heard this week. But you know what? We need to be like that about spiritual food. You know, remember I told you that Pentecost is a feast day. Now, when I was a child and I would hear about feast days, I immediately thought about food. But that's not the kind of feast day that we're talking about here. It's a spiritual feast day is one of the feasts of the Lord. Now, sometimes they might have a meal, but they would do a lot of fasting before the feast day because they had to get ready for the day of the Lord. And you look back there at that first Pentecost, and you realize why they got to fast and get ready for that feast day. Because look at what happened. Those people weren't ready for Pentecost. And they were in idolatry. And they fell. And I don't mean they fell down. They fell down dead. 3,000 of them because they were in idolatry. But then all of a sudden in Acts chapter 2, they were ready for that feast day. And God filled them up to overflowing. Said that there was a sound from heaven as of a rushing in a mighty wind, and all of a sudden it filled the house, and tongues of fire sat upon each one of them, and it was just glorious. Can you imagine what that day must have been like? Wow! Praise God. You know, the only thing I can imagine is I remember years ago, you know, said that people aren't hungry anymore for revival. I remember a time where people were hungry for revival and they'd stand in line for hours to get into the sanctuary. I remember getting to be a part of those revivals, some of them. And I didn't realize what a blessing it was to get to see that kind of revival take place and just to feel what I felt in those places and to see God moving. But you know what came out of it? This is the kind of miracles we'd see when people get hungry for God. I remember a lady in one church, when I first went there, she said, Brother Ron, we're starving spiritually. And I said, okay, well, we can take care of that. I said, we're going to have Sunday night Bible study, Wednesday night Bible study. We're going to have prayer services 3 days a week at lunchtime. We close up the office, right? We're about to close up the office. We're going to have prayer service. And do you know what? She was there every prayer service, every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night. And then we'd also have revival. And then she was there for every revival in that church, but not just those revivals, but any other revival that I had a part in or anybody in our church had a part in. She was there. And then there was a group of people that began to go to those things. And every time the church doors were open, they were always there. And then we started having another Bible study besides those that I just told you during midweek. It was up in the afternoon. And we'd make it fit their schedule. And they were there. And you know what came out of those kind of prayer meetings and those kind of revivals and those kind of hungers for the Lord? Well, I remember a lady who was in that church, and she had cataracts and other things going on with her eyes. And the Lord told me that we were going to be able to lay hands on her that Sunday and she was going to be healed. And you know what happened? That's what happened. She was healed. And I remember her getting up there and the Lord told me just what to do. Now, it sounds odd, but hey, I just listen to what God says and we just do it. And the Lord said to have her read the Bible and we're going to pray for her. And then she read some more Bible, and she wasn't able to read much of it because she couldn't see it. And then we prayed again. And then she read some more, a little bit, and she could read just a little bit at a time. And then we kept praying for her, and we kept doing this for probably about 20 minutes. Went on in the service. And you know what happened? She was healed. And she never had a cataract surgery, to my knowledge. That's what happened. God healed her. I've seen it happen. You know, there was another lady one time who had macular degeneration. And this was, we're backing up now, going to another church, backing up in the years. This would be about, I was asking Amy the other day, I think this is about 16 years ago when this happened. We went to this church, and there was this lady named Mildred Smith. And Miss Mildred was from North Mississippi. And she was, at that time, I think, up in her 80s, late 80s. And she couldn't see anymore. But she was able to walk, but she was able just to, you know, see shadows. She said that, I can't see, you know, faces or read words. And she said she was in church one day. And she said, Lord, you know I love to go to church. Please, Lord, I can hear the sermon, but Lord, please let me see the preacher's face while he's preaching. And you know what? The Lord did it for her. And she came up to me afterwards. She said, Brother Ron, she said, I was praying back there. I wanted to be able to see the preacher's face while he's preaching. She said, from then on, till she died, she was about 100 when she died. And, you know, she was, every time the preacher preached, she'd be able to see the preacher's face. God is good all the time, isn't he? You know, God just does mighty works. But we need to get hungry for the Lord. And they were hungry that day in Acts 2. And we need to be hungry the same way. I'll tell you this story, then we're going to close. In Joel, how it said, let me read that again just a little bit. It said, your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. I want to get this guy up here if I can. He said he's real shy in public. But he's an ex-military. And we were on a campout about 6 weeks ago, me and John Clayton. And it's fathers and the sons in Trail Life. And it's kind of similar to the Boy Scouts, but it's more like a Sunday school version of it, where they really are pushing Jesus, okay? And so we're at this, and it's a lot of pastors and other daddies there. And I was talking with one of the preachers, and as we're talking, this ex-military guy is talking with us, and he's standing there, and all of a sudden he says, you know, he said, I've never told this, but I just feel like I'm supposed to. He said, I've been reading the Bible a lot more lately than I ever have before. And he said, and as I've been reading through the Bible, I got to this book called Joel. And he said, and I came to this part where it says about the old men and the young men, and that they're going to prophesy, and that they're going to dream dreams, that kind of stuff. And I said, yeah, that's Joel chapter 2. And he said, I read that. And he said, you know, that's happened to me before. And I said, really? I said, what do you mean? He said, well, I've never told this, but I feel like I'm supposed to. And he said, I've had two spiritual dreams. He said, they've been years ago. He said, the first one, he said, it was a recurring dream. He said, I'm standing over here like on a hill. And I'm able to look down, and over here is a city. And then I see, like heaven, and the stairwell coming down. And he said, an angel's flying in out of heaven into the city. And then the angel's coming out of the city going back up into heaven. And he said, and I see this. And he said, and they kept flying down and back up. And he said, and then also on that stairwell, I saw people lined up, going up. And he said, but I'm not with them. I'm over here on this hill. And he said, and I can hear screaming going on in the city, and that the city's on fire. It's actually on fire. And he said, it's like warfare going on down there. And then he said, and I kept having this dream. And he said, finally, whenever I gave my life to Christ, he said, that was the last time I ever saw the dream. He said, but at that point, I'm standing. He said, I'm no longer on the plateau. He said, now I'm in that group that's going up on the staircase. And he said, but as I'm standing there, I hear familiar voices in the screaming. And they're saying, why didn't you tell me? why didn't you tell us about Jesus? He said, Brother Ron, what do you think that means? I said, I think you need to be telling people. You need to be telling people about Jesus. You need to tell that dream. That's prophetic. It's a fulfillment of this passage in Joel. He said, I didn't know that the Bible said things like that, that we were going to have visions and dreams. He said, I had one other dream. And he said, and this is the last one that I've had. And he said, and it was, he said, here in the, he said, we're in a, like on the interstate. And the traffic's backed up. And he said, and it's like everybody's just waiting and you can't move. I mean, it's literally like not moving at all. And so people begin to get out of the cars to look up ahead to see what's going on and what's the holdup. When all of a sudden, he said, there's this huge boom and it's so loud, Brother Ron. He said, oh, it was loud. And it's startling. He said, people begin to scream when they heard this loud boom. And he said, and all of a sudden, we saw Jesus coming out on the clouds. And he said, and I screamed too. And then all of a sudden, he said, I felt sad that I screamed because, he said, when I saw it was Jesus. He said, like as if I was sad that I had had a lack of faith. Or like as if I wasn't quite ready. And I think the message today is that we need to be hungry for God. We need to be getting closer to the Lord. And we need to be ready for revival. But then, because I believe we're going to have a revival at the end of time before the Lord Jesus comes back. I believe we're going to see it. It'll be in our lifetime. We are going to see it. I think we're going to see it. And then I believe that then the Lord Jesus is going to return. And so we need to be ready for the Lord's return. And we need to be getting other people ready. And we need to make sure that we're ready to receive what the Lord has for us. And so, you know, and I know you can get ready. Y'all can do it. We can do this together, all of us. And we can be hungry. And so if you say, well, I just haven't been hungry in a long time, and I want to be, but I'm just not. We have not because we ask not. Just ask the Lord, say, Lord, please, Lord, just increase my appetite. Lord, give me spiritual vitamins to increase my appetite, Lord. So that I want more of you and I hunger after your word and the Lord will give it to us. I know it will. Because that's the kind of God that we serve. Will you stand?
Our hymn presentation is hymn number 684. Precious Lord, take my hand. Let's sing both stanzas, hymn number 684.
And carry your word in their hearts, in the name of Christ.